Welcome. I'm Peggy, and I have a wonderful lady sitting here with me on the set with a beautiful name. Her name is Daphne Jones, and that's a name you don't hear very often. Daphne, it has kind of a musical ring to it. Thank you. Bless you for coming.
Thank you very much.
This is an honor to have you. And she has written a book. I know, there are a lot of people out there writing books. This is something special. And it's called Our Southern Breeze. And there's a reason for this book. It isn't just a novel that you pick up to escape. This is the real thing. Mm-hmm. And it was based on something that happened. There was a man from the New York Times called Ron Hall, and he wrote a book called Some Kind of Different. Is that it?
Same kind of difference as me.
And the book was about your twin sister, mm-hmm. who was his wife. Mm-hmm. And then this came along, mm-hmm. Our Southern Breeze.
That's correct.
Tell me about it.
Well, before Deborah died, she died of colon cancer, really I think it's about 12 years ago. And she made friends with a homeless man who was on the streets of Fort Worth, Texas. And God showed her his heart. And she fell in love with him, he fell in love with her, and connected Ron and Denver together. And Ron is her husband, Denver Moore is the homeless man. We went through that journey of their friendship, and when we found out she had cancer, she managed to live and fight to live for 19 months. And when she died, Denver told Ron, said, "Mr. Ron, we gotta tell our story. Nobody's gonna believe it." So they started writing their book, and it was published, Same Kind of Different as Me.
And it was a bestseller.
Not only was it a bestseller, but probably, I think to date, close to $70 million has been raised for the homeless through Denver and Ron's speaking engagements and sales of the book. So I don't know too many times when a book has brought that much money
back in.
And
many people out there may have read it and know this book, yeah. Same Kind of Different as me. And then you took up the story.
Well, what happened as Ron and Denver started speaking around the United States and people found out that she had a twin sister, they started saying, "Well, we want to know more about
you couldn't
the
say
Miss
hidden.
Debbie." I mean, who could tell the story better than her twin
That's
sister?
Right.
So I had been journaling for a long time, and I decided that for the first time, maybe I should tell my story. My audience is different. It's not about homelessness. It's about brokenness and how we have a God who can forgive, restore, and give second chances. So I wrote the book for a year by myself, and then God really brought a wonderful woman in my life, Andrea Taylor, and we wrote together for another year. The book was published December of this past year, and I didn't really know why the book came out. I think God had a plan all along, but my pastor, who actually read the book and had me come in our church and speak about it, he said, "I don't know if you realize it, but God's opened up a ministry for you." What I did, Peggy, is I took my mask of shame off and I just told the story. All the brokenness, and it's not easy to talk about things that you want to hide behind,
yeah.
But most of us hide behind some kind of mask.
And this book is about abuse.
It is.
Yeah.
Deborah and I...
We have a picture, a cover of this book, and maybe we could... There. That's you and your sister as twins,
mm-hmm.
little girls.
That's right.
On the cover of the book. I want people to see that.
Now, at that point in time, we had not been abused. We never stopped holding hands. She held my hand, and she was 5 minutes older, so she was the stronger of the two, and she managed to boss me around until she died. But the difference is, once we suffered from the abuse of our father, there was sexual abuse, but there was also mental and physical abuse. It split Deborah and me completely, just completely emotionally. She didn't hold my hand anymore, and I had to figure out how to fend for myself. We had an older sister, Gretchen. Unfortunately, my mother started her on narcotics by the time she started her period, and therefore she became addicted to prescription medicine. So we were all split emotionally just for different reasons.
And where was your mother in all of this?
She managed every Friday. She was a school teacher, and she managed every Friday to get a migraine headache, and she would be in bed until Monday morning. So we were just kind of on our own.
You raised yourself then, really?
We really did. And, you know, you do have to forgive, but what happened, and I know with twins, it happened for us, but she went one way and I went the other way. She became very cold, withdrawn, and she was a perfectionist. I mean, she had to be perfect in everything she did. Perfect grades, perfect everything. What happened to me, because love was shown the wrong way, I was hungry to be loved, but my daddy showed it to me the way that he shouldn't have. So therefore, I started being very promiscuous early on. Also, by the time I was in the seventh grade, I think that's when depression set in for me. And that's one of the side effects from abuse is depression. It's just when you hold things on the inside, it's going to come out in depression. Well, because I couldn't concentrate and I couldn't learn because I was depressed, even though we didn't talk about it, I thought I was dumb and stupid.
Well, you couldn't do well in school.
And I had to keep up with Deborah to keep from getting punished. So by the time I was in the seventh grade, I started cheating. Now that was the hardest thing to admit. I never learned anything past the seventh grade. And that decision that I was dumb and stupid, I lived that life out, and it created horrible fear in me that someone would find out that my secret. And so by the time I was 19, I was pregnant and had to get married. I wasn't one bit equipped to be a mother. I didn't physically abuse my daughter, but I neglected her because I was so broken on the inside, I had nothing to give her. Well, the story goes on, and I just lived that brokenness, even though I managed to have a job. I got, you know, people saw me on the outside that I was okay, but I didn't think I was okay. So I kind of went through life hiding, and people saw more in me than I saw in myself.
So we hear all the time about abuse in this country.
You bet.
And children, I mean, it's shocking. And every time you pick up the newspaper or turn on the 11 o'clock news at night or something, there are stories concerning the abuse and children and women. And many times it's a cover up because they go through life as you did and nobody knows what happened.
No, everybody kept secrets. I think people talk a little more open now.
It's getting better.
It is getting better. But I think if I told you what was the purpose of my book is to give hope. Now, unfortunately, I kind of went through life thinking I was dumb and stupid and doing the best I could, turning down any opportunity that came along that I might have to be tested. I was scared to death. That word would put me in a panic. And so I kind of lived that life of being dumb and stupid for a long time. I also was suicidal. That's another side effect of abuse. And I can remember standing in front of a mirror screaming as loud as I could because I was in so much pain. I wrote a lot of goodbye letters, but then by the time I'd finish and I'd be crying, I would quit writing. But every day I felt like I was being sucked into a deep, dark hole with no way to get out. But our marriage lasted nearly 18 years. Right at the time we were in the process of divorcing, I got so desperate and the pain was so bad that I put my car in the garage and I was ready to die. No letters, no anything. I just kind of cut off from reality. I was found and I was put in the hospital, a psychiatric hospital. And at that point, my doctor said, let's put you through test. I want to find out what's wrong with you. I think he already knew the answer. Mm-hmm. He just wanted me to know. Well, the test came back and he said I was intelligent. I can remember sitting in that chair trying to comprehend what he was saying. All of a sudden I realized Satan had told me a lie a long time ago and I believed it. And I lived that life out. Now what I had to do was I either had to continue to live that life, which was, it was pretty easy for me, or I had to step forward in a lot of faith and say, I'm going to live a different life. I didn't want to be dumb and stupid anymore.
Well, now, when you were a child and all this abuse happened, your mother sort of, did your mother know what was going on and that was the way she escaped reality to have these headaches? And your father was in the home. He was there.
Oh, yes, he was.
And then when you became pregnant and married the father of your child, you were married for 18 years.
Yes, I was.
And then there was a divorce.
Well, we had another child 5 years after my daughter was born. But when we divorced, you know, for the first time I was alone. And then I really sunk down even lower. Now, there is going to be a better part of this story.
But Daphne, I just love your name. you had all this trauma as a child and as a young adult in your life. Mm-hmm. And obviously, there was no stability there or Christian atmosphere.
No.
And see, you can't give what you don't have.
That's it right there.
And if your children are grown in a home without love or where they're abused verbally even, this is, God has to intervene.
Yes. Well,
is that right?
He did intervene in an amazing way.
I can see
way.
That in your face,
in
your eyes, and your lovely smile.
He did intervene. And the reason that I named the book Our Southern Breeze is because of the change that took place. And that happened at Anaheim, California, at a healing conference.
All right, we are going to take a break and come back. This is a real life story that's happening, unfortunately, too many times. And we do have a phone number and a website, and we'll be right back because I want to know more. If you tuned in late, my special guest today is Daphne Jones, and she makes her home in Atlanta, Georgia. And she is a remarkable woman, and God has led you from terrible trials and tragedy, really, to forgiveness and victory.
Yes, yes.
And you've written the book called Our Southern Breeze, and you said in Anaheim, California, something happened that changed your life and wiped all the darkness away.
Yes. Deborah, who we really were not close for all those years, she called me one day.
That's your twin sister.
My twin sister, Deborah. And she said that she wanted me to go to Anaheim, California to a healing conference. And she'd pay for everything. Well, I thought that things were going to be great with us finally. So we got to Anaheim, we ended up rooming together. And when the lights went out, she said, are you asleep? Well, I got real excited thinking that now we're gonna make up for all those years. And I said, no, I'm not. And she said, I know you want me to tell you I love you, but I don't. She said, you have been such a disappointment to me. Well, all of a sudden, I mean, I realized not only was I a disappointment to my twin sister, but I was a disappointment to myself. And she didn't bring me to Anaheim for our relationship to be restored. She wanted God to heal me and all the mistakes that I had been making for so many years. Well, the weekend was amazing.
It was a healing conference?
It was.
Okay.
It was beautiful. And all of a sudden, during one of the times that we were there, God touched my heart so profoundly that I wanted to be alone. Now, I wasn't real sure. This was new to me, but I thought, I've got to be by myself. So I went into our room, and I just began to weep for my lost life. And that's really what it was. I cried out to God to forgive me for all the mistakes I had made. For the mistakes I had made, I was actually married twice. To not know how to be a mother, and to have lost so much of my children's lives, and just the mistakes with my sisters. I don't know how long I was there, but when I got up, I was different. God had restored me completely.
And have you been able to forgive your father?
Oh, heavens yes. You know, that was already beginning because okay. You can't go forward until you've experienced forgiveness. And I never was able to tell him directly, but in my heart, God knew I had forgiven him.
Right.
And I forgave my mother for not being able to take care of us. But when I went back to the session, they were singing, "There's No God Like Jehovah." And the longer they sang, the bigger it got. And Deborah always made sure we were separate and not sitting next to each other. And all of a sudden, she looked down, and Peggy, she mouthed the words, "I love you." We ran together and embraced for the first time since that picture shows us holding hands. And for all of a sudden, God had brought us back together as twins. Well, when we were leaving that night, unbeknown to us, a man came up to us and he said, "God has given me a word for the two of you. Would you receive it?" He said, "God has shown me 5 icebergs." Well, there were 5 in our family. Mm-hmm. And he said, "He's sending a southern breeze to melt the hardest of hearts. And one day you'll look back and your lives will never be the same." Well, of course, that's why the book is named Our Southern Breeze. This is God's
beautiful
story.
Beautiful.
Well, by the time we left Anaheim, I had no idea what God had in store for me. Things began to happen faster than I could even tell you. One morning I woke up at 4:30 in the morning, and God had shown me a vision of what he wanted me to do with my life. Well, after I heard from him in Anaheim, I pretty much thought I better listen. I got up and I timed it, and I wrote everything I saw in this vision that he gave me. And I call those spiritual markers. That's when God marks something in your life he wants you to mm-hmm. remember. I quit a real job with a real paycheck, and I started my company, DJ Consultants. I didn't even know how to write a business letter. Now,
okay.
All those stories are in the book, but I began a journey of being fearless. I wasn't afraid of anybody.
And now you do have a ministry that,
I mean,
other things have opened up that you didn't
yes.
dream about.
You know, I'm finding that I'm able to speak to women in churches, and I do book clubs.
And when you speak to women and in churches, what do you say? What do you tell these women? Because some of those people that you may not know it,
mm-hmm.
but they're hiding behind something that happened to them.
You bet. You know, it's amazing after I speak, because I am very open when I speak to women. I need to be. But what happens when I finish talking, so many people come up and they said, "I've been somewhere where you've been." And I'm just encouraging them to tell your story. Don't hide behind it, because your story is going to be able to help somebody else. You know, Peggy, I got a letter from I think this woman was 83 years old. I don't know how she got my book, but I got a letter in the mail, and she said that she had been abused when she was 3 years old. And when they took her to the hospital, her daddy said if she wouldn't tell anything about it, he would buy her an ice cream cone. And so, I mean, it's my story is not as bad as a lot of them, I can tell you that, but I'm willing to tell it. And I'm not embarrassed anymore to hide behind that mask of shame. I mean, God has me writing a book. I'm an author. I go out and speak, and I run a company.
And you were the young girl who thought you were such a poor student.
That's right. That's right. And you know what? I'd like to even speak to people and students in school, because just that cheating alone altered my life. But I wasn't dumb and stupid. I just said I was so and believed it.
So you cheated just to get through school.
That's it. That's it. But you know what God did that's so amazing? He took a little area of my life that he knew I could excel in. I do know how to manage time and information. And do you know that I started my company with that much knowledge, and I've ended up working in corporate America. Nobody's ever asked, where'd you graduate from college? What was your grade point? They just see that I know what I'm doing. They believe me, and I have a passion to make a difference. Well, now God is using my book to make a difference.
It's a powerful story.
Thank you.
And it's so painful to think that there are children out there who are hurting, and perhaps no one can reach out to them.
Or I think you're right. A mother
mm-hmm. who knows something mm-hmm. is happening, maybe mm-hmm. will find the courage to take a stand.
Well, I will tell you one thing. I didn't let my children read the book at all when I was writing my manuscript. It was God's story, and I didn't want a lot of people to tell me what I couldn't say.
Well, you said you kept a journal. Do you still keep a journal?
No, that's what's so odd about it. I started journaling on my way home from Anaheim, and I journaled all those years. And I think that's what makes the book powerful, is because it's got raw emotion in it. It's got the excitement. I've got some great stories. I actually, now believe it or not, picked up and sold my home, my car, and I moved to Manhattan, and I lived there for quite a few years. Now, this is a girl that was scared of her shadow, that I was all of a sudden brave enough to move to Manhattan and work. So it's a fun, the first half of the book is hard to read. The second half is exciting because it does show what God can do to brokenness. He's just waiting to forgive and restore us.
And what do you say to people out there and say, well, that's wonderful, but she's an exception. Isn't God, he doesn't just limit to one person.
No. You know, for the longest time, Peggy, I thought what happened to me in Anaheim was magical. I realized all I did is I went before God Almighty and just cried out to him. And he was just waiting with his hands open to forgive me and restore me and ready to take me on a new journey. He took me back where I was supposed to be all along and let me travel this exciting journey that he has me on. Every day is a wonderful day for me. You know what, Deborah, when Deborah was dying, every morning she'd wake up and say, God, thank you for waking me up. And that's what I try to do when I wake up in the morning.
What a lovely thought.
Mm-hmm.
You thank God.
Just for waking up.
This is an inspiring story, and we do have a phone number and a website. And the phone number is 770-831-9545. And also the website. And you would be available to speak at women's groups and churches.
Oh, yes.
Mm-hmm. If somebody were to call you.
Oh, yes. Uh-huh. And really, that's where my ministry is. I'm surprised at, you know, you think everybody's okay at church. There are a lot of people that come with a big smile on their face, and behind it, they're hiding their secrets too. So I hope God can use me. And I do have a ministry. I didn't know that I would have one at my age, but I do. And I want to take advantage of it.
And you still are active in the business world?
No,
I'm not so much now.
No, I'm Debbie Kirtland, who's worked with me for a long time. She's beginning to run the company because this is where I think God wants me.
Mm-hmm. But you were involved in big business.
We've been very fortunate. And some of the stories are fun in the
story.
Book.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. Our Southern Breeze. And it is available at Barnes & Noble?
Well,
it's available through your website?
You can get it at Barnes & Noble on the website. You can order the book. And then also our website is a great place.
Thank you, Daphne, for sharing your life with us and the blessings that are coming from your life. You're no longer wounded. You're victorious.
Amen to that.
And that's what we all need to strive for.
Oh, thank you so much.
Thank
you for having me.
And wherever you are, we just never need to give up, do we? Stay happy. We'll see you next time.